Welcome back. We were discussing characteristic function and its properties. So, yesterday I was in a bit of a hurry to prove this result on uniform continuity, right. So, I will just redo the, I will just recap what we said and finish the proof, ok. So, Cx of t is the characteristic function of x, ok, of some random variable x. And Cx of t is a non-negative kernel. So, uniform continuity, so these two I think I spelled out yesterday what these two really mean. So, uniform continuity, so if you want to deal with right, so uniform continuity means for all t there exists a function phi of h which goes to 0 as h goes to 0, h can go to 0 like that, as h goes to 0. So that absolute value of Cx of t plus h minus Cx of t, this difference is upper bounded by, so it is bounded by phi of h, ok. That is what this uniform continuity means. It is a stronger notion of, it is stronger than continuity, ok. Uniform continuity is stronger than continuity, but weaker than differentiability, ok, it is somewhere in between. So this really means, so continuity means that this difference goes to 0 as h goes to 0, but equicontinuity means that regardless of what t is, I can uniformly find an upper bound for this difference. That is why it is called uniform continuity, right. So, this difference is, this does not really depend on t, it is bounded irrespective of t, see what I mean. So, that is why it is called uniform continuity, ok. So, we were trying to prove this. So, we said that the difference, so we took this difference, right, absolute value of e to the I t plus h x minus e to the I t x, right, we took that and we said this is equal to we said this is less than or equal to expectation of the absolute value of e power I h x minus 1, right? We got till here yesterday, right? Okay, so this is just, this was just simplifying this left hand side. Now I'm going to claim that this is in fact my phi of h. Okay, and I have to show that this phi of h goes to 0 as h goes to 0. Correct. So now the claim is that, so I want to send, so I want to put limit outside here, right? First, I am going to establish that the random variable inside, let me call this random variable some y of h for lack of better notation. Okay, let me call this y of h. Okay, so this random variable, so y of h is a non-negative random variable clearly, right? So this y of h we said is, yeah, it's just the absolute value of e power I h x minus 1. If you write this as cos h x plus I times sin h s h x, you get this is equal to square root of 1 minus cos h x squared plus sin squared h x, right? Just simplify this out, is it right? So I will have cos squared plus sin squared, which gives me 1. There is already a 1 that will give me 2. So that gives me square root of 2 minus 2 cos h x. Okay. Okay, this is cos of h x, not hyperbolic cosine. Okay, cos of h x. So this on further simplification, so 1 minus cos is 2 sin square h x by 2, right? So that if you do that identity, you get 2 times absolute value of sin h x over 2. So that is my random variable. Y of h is nothing but twice sin h x over 2. Okay. Now, so that is my random variable. Now I have to show that the expectation of this random variable goes to 0 as h goes to 0, correct? But it is clear that this random variable goes to 0, right, as h goes to 0, this random variable itself goes to 0, correct? But absolute value of y h is also less than or equal to 2, right? So this whole thing is less than or equal to 2. So dominated convergence theorem implies that you can take the limit inside, correct? Because it is bounded above uniformly by 2, right? Now the sequence of functions, okay, the one thing is the sequence of functions is indexed by h, which is not really a, it is not a sequence in n, it is not a sequence of, it is not a discrete sequence, but it does not really matter, right? H is going along any, going to 0 any way, but that is okay, right? Dominated convergence theorem applies even in that case. So here you will have by DCT limit h tending to 0 expectation of yh is equal to 0, right, which means we have what we want. Okay, so that proves uniform continuity. So by dominated convergence theorem this follows. Okay, so if you are given a characteristic, if you are given a function which is continuous, which is discontinuous, there is no way the function is going to be a characteristic function of any random variable, right? Because all characteristic functions are uniformly continuous. Okay. C means, so property number C, Cx of t is a non-negative kernel, means that for, so this is what you have to show, for any n and t1, t2 dot 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 tn in R and z1, z2 dot 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 zn in complex, z1, z2, zn complex. We have, we must have that sum over j k z j c x of t j minus t k z k bar is greater than or equal to 0. Okay. So, all complex quadratic forms are non negative, that is what it means to say that c x of t is a non negative kernel. So, you fix whatever t j's you want, whatever z j's you want in complex numbers, and then you are writing down the matrix of. So, you basically what you are doing here is, in other words, so in other words, so you are writing down, so z 1 dot 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 z n, and then you are writing down the matrix of. So, the j kth term here is c x of t j minus t k, okay, and all the diagonal entries will be 1 as we discussed yesterday, and then these are z 1 bar through z n bar, right. So, you are looking at a complex matrix and a basically a complex quadratic form, is not it, and all these quadratic forms have to be non negative, that is what this says, okay, for any characteristic function. The way you prove that, so this guy, so the LHS, so I am going to say this left hand side, all this stuff is equal to sum over j comma k integral z j e power I t j x times z k e z k bar e power minus I t k x. D P x. Right, you agree with that? So, I am, what am I doing, right? So, I am just writing out, so I am just writing out this as an integral, and so actually I have not even pulled it out. So, I have just written out this integral, this as an integral, this is integral of e power I t j minus t k x, which is what I have written down here, dpx, right. I have not assumed a density or anything, right, it is a very general characteristic function, and I have simply, so I have skipped one step I guess, because I have taken the tj with the zj and tk with the zk bar. I think so far you will have no problem, right. So, now, okay, so now you have to realize that this is a squared term, okay. So, this is actually, if I give you, write it down, you will realize that this is in fact a squared term. So, this is going to be expectation of absolute value of z j, well sum over j z j, sum over j z j e power I t j x absolute value squared. And therefore, this is non negative. So, I am saying that, okay, so it is easier to see that this is equal to that rather than the other way around, right. So, if you take this expectation of, I have this complex expression here whose absolute value squared I am taking expectation of. Okay, you know that for a complex number absolute value of z squared is equal to z z bar, right. So, you apply that result, so you multiply this guy with its complex conjugate and you multiply term by term, you will actually get this, okay, and there is of course some interchange of integral and summation that is needed, okay. Fine. So you just expand this out as z z bar and you will get this expression, and this is clearly non-negative, okay. So characteristic functions are non-negative kernels, non-negative definite kernels, okay. So these three properties, so there are a few other properties I listed of the characteristic function, right. These three are particularly core properties in some sense. So I call these defining properties in some sense, right, defining properties of CF. So these three are called defining properties of characteristic functions. So far we have only proved that any characteristic function has to have this property. What is remarkable is that any function that satisfies these three properties are also characteristic functions of some random variable. These three properties are enough, there is no more further properties that are needed, okay. The converse result is a more involved theorem, okay. It is called Bochner's theorem, you might have heard of it, Bochner, right. So maybe I will make a remark. Remark, according to Bochner's theorem, Bochner, the three properties above are sufficient for a function to be the CF of a random variable. Okay. So we have proved the forward result, we have proved that every characteristic function must have these three properties, okay. This is what I am saying here is the opposite, right, there are no further properties that are needed. So if you manage to verify these three properties, if I give you some function of t, f of t, right, and you manage to verify these three properties, that f of t is the necessarily a characteristic function of some random variable, okay. So in these three properties are some sense defining properties of a characteristic function in this sense, actually in the sense of Bochner's theorem, okay, which is why I mean this is a little hard to digest. You may be wondering why I put this down, right, this for example this non-negative kernel business, it is actually a very core property, although it is a little awkward to state, okay. So if you manage, so every Bochner's theorem says that every uniformly continuous non-negative kernel is the characteristic function of a random variable, yes. This modulus square, actually it's, let me before saying, let me just check it out, I think I made a mistake, huh, summation, so the absolute value, yes this is correct, this is correct, okay. And then you this absolute value square you expand as zz bar, that is it, you will get it, okay. So this remark is just for your information, we will not prove Bochner's theorem. Okay. So there is also the inversion theorem. I did not state in full generality, and I believe I made a small mistake. So I will actually state the inversion theorem again. Okay. inversion theorem for characteristic functions. It basically says that if you know the characteristic function, you know the distribution of the random variable. Okay. The possessed statement is as follows. So these three I am just stating as three results, okay. I am not going to prove them. If x is a continuous random variable with density fx, and cf cx, then fx of x is equal to limit t tending to infinity 1 over 2 pi minus t to t cx of t e power minus I t x dt at every point at which f x is differentiable. I think I said continuous yesterday, okay. This is what Grimmett and Sturzecker has. F x is differentiable, okay. And this may not, I mean this relation may not hold at points where f x is discontinuous or non differentiable, okay. Also, by looking at a characteristic function, there is an easy way to identify whether it corresponds to a continuous random variable or not. Okay. So, a characteristic function is defined for all random variables, right. So, there is a, let me state number 2, a sufficient but not necessary condition for the characteristic function cx to be the characteristic function of a continuous random variable is absolute integrability. So, basically if you have integral minus infinity infinity absolute value of cx of t dt is then infinity. So, if your characteristic function is absolutely integrable, then it is necessarily true that the random variable is a continuous random variable, there will be a density, okay. But the converse need not be true, it may be true that there is a density, but the characteristic function may not be integrable, absolutely integrable, okay. Yeah, so it's a little bit like, so if you're looking at, so you can kind of believe the statement, right? So if you're looking this at this inverse transform relationship, you will have the absolute value of this is less than or equal to the absolute value of that, which is less than or equal to the integral of the absolute value, right? Therefore, if you have that the integral of the absolute value is finite, you can expect the uniform absolute convergence and hence the uniform convergence of the inverse transform, right. Therefore, the density will exist as a equicontinuous function, okay, the uniformly continuous function actually, okay. So, this is believable in light of this, okay. I will not prove it again, but okay. It is not, so you can find examples of characteristic functions which are not absolutely integrable, but still x has a density. Okay, think about if you can see if you can think of such a example. Okay, the characteristic function is not absolutely integrable, but x has a density. Okay. 3. So the most general inversion theorem is this, right? So general inversion theorem. Let f(x) denote the CDF of x and Cx its characteristic function. Define f hat from R to 0, 1 as f hat of x equal to half f of x plus limit y going to x from below f of y, f x of y. Maybe I should call this f x hat. Okay. Then equals limit t tending to infinity integral minus t to t 1/2 pi e power minus I a t minus e power minus I b t over I t c x of t dt. Okay. So this is a hard theorem to prove. Okay. This just says that you can f, what I mean is f hat. Okay. This is the f hat function. So what this result says is that if you have any CDF, right, need not necessarily be a continuous random variable or any structure, no further structure is needed. If you are given its characteristic function, you can effectively obtain the CDF. Okay, that is what this is saying. Now let me help you interpret this fx hat. Okay, this fx hat is a function that is almost looks like your CDF fx, except that at points of discontinuity it takes the middle value of the discontinuity. Okay, see you know that CDFs are not necessarily continuous, but they are right continuous, right. So you are looking at fx plus the left limit of the CDF, which need not always be equal to the functional value, right. So in some sense you are averaging the right limit and the left limit, which means you are looking at the midpoint of a discontinuity of your CDF. But of course if f is continuous, these two will be equal and you will get back your fx. Correct. So this fx hat is equal to your CDF wherever the CDF is continuous. If fx is not continuous at some point, you will, this fx hat will take the middle point as the value. Okay. See, this fx hat is not quite a CDF because it is not right continuous, right, it is taking all these middle values. So it is like a proxy CDF, but almost approximates your CDF. Now what this is saying is that if you perform this inverse transformation, right, if you perform this inverse transformation, you don't quite recover your CDF, but you recover this CDF which converges, which except at points of discontinuity converges to the middle point. Everywhere else you recover your CDF. So for example, in particular if you send a to minus infinity, right, you will recover your f hat, right. But from f hat going to f x is very easy, right. Why? So you keep the, at the points of continuity they are equal. At points of discontinuity, you'll converge to the middle value. You simply make it right continuous. Then you get back your CDF. Okay. So performing this almost gives you the CDF, but you know the CDF has to be right continuous. So wherever it converges to the middle point, you take it up to the right continuity, the right limit point, right, and then you will recover your CDF. That's what this is saying. Okay. So these theorems require a lot of harmonic analysis and complex variables machinery to prove. Okay. They're fairly non-trivial results. Okay. It's generally I just put it down to show that you know you can completely recover the CDF from the characteristic function. Any questions? No, what I'm saying is suppose you have a situation where the CDF, so the CDF may have some jump like that, right? So usually, so the functional value of the CDF will always be here because CDFs are necessarily right continuous. But if you blindly perform this inversion, this is like a Fourier transform inversion, right? If you perform that, the function you recover f hat will be fine at all points of continuity, but whenever there is a discontinuity, this is a feature of all these Fourier theorems, okay, you converge to the middle point. Okay. So this is a standard feature that occurs in even in Fourier series, you get a situation like this, right. So if you write down the Fourier series of a square wave or something, you get convergence here, you get convergence here, but at jumps you get convergence to the middle point, right. I think you may know that. So all these Fourier type results have this this quirky property, right? You always converge to the middle point, but you know that the function is a CDF after all, so you cannot be here, you have to be here, right? You just redefine it and you have recovered your CDF.
And ultimately it have to be continuous.
Which one?
Ultimately it have to be
which continuous. One? F hat need not be continuous. F hat need not be continuous. Okay. If Cx is absolutely integrable, then it will have some very nice properties, as I said here. If Cx is absolutely integrable, you will in fact have a density which is absolutely continuous. Okay. So now I will. Talk about moments from characteristic functions. So exactly like you can recover your moments from the moment generating function, you can also recover it from the characteristic function. Okay, except with an added advantage that the characteristic function will always exist, the moment generating function need not always exist. Okay. So let me write it this way. If Cx of t, the kth derivative of Cx of t, okay, this means kth derivative of Cx of t exists at t equal to 0, then expected value of absolute value of x power k less than infinity for k even and absolute expected value of absolute value of k minus 1 is finite. For k odd. B, if expectation of if some kth moment exists, then so if the k is the expected absolute value of x power k is less than infinity, then C x, the kth derivative of C x evaluated at 0 equals I power k times expected x power k. So, the kth moment is kth moment multiplied by I power k is the kth derivative at 0. So, you get this I power k, I mean this is the moment generating function, you do not get this I power k, right. There is no, you have to put this I power k for this characteristic function, okay. Further, and this is going to be important later, you can actually Taylor expand the characteristic function in terms of its moments, okay. So, you will notice that I am not improving, not proving a great majority of results here, right, in all this, it is they are fairly involved. So, further, C x of t admits this Taylor expansion j equals 0 to k. Expectation of x power j over factorial j I t to the j plus little o of t power k. Okay. So, this is the moment generating property of the characteristic function. So, you can look at the characteristic function and say whether certain moments are finite or not. So, if the kth, what this part A is saying is, if the kth derivative is finite at t equal to 0, then the kth moment exists for k even, and k minus 1 the existing moment is actually finite for k odd, okay. And this part, so you by looking at the characteristic function you can say a certain moments are finite, and this part says if your kth moment the absolute value of x power k has finite moment, then you can actually recover expectation of x power k by differentiating the characteristic function k times and setting t equal to 0, okay. And of course, it is an I power k here, okay. Now, this part of the result says that you can Taylor expand, you can basically Taylor expand C x of t in terms of the moments, okay. This should not be altogether surprising for you after all, because this is nothing but expectation of e power I t x, right. So, you can write this as 1 plus I t x plus you know I t x squared over 2 factorial, you can Taylor expand that. I mean the tricky bit is in bringing the expectation inside, right, and that you can do when this condition is satisfied, that is what this theorem is saying, right. Otherwise it is trivial, right, the trick is in bringing the expectation in, okay. So, you can sum to the kth moment where you know it exists, right, and the correction term is little o t to the k. You know what little o is? Essentially terms that go to 0 quicker than t to the k as t goes to 0, okay. So, this will be like t to the k plus 1 or some bunch of terms that go to 0 faster than t to the k, okay. So, this is going to be useful later, okay. In fact, this is the property that will help us prove some very important results such as central limit theorem and weak law of large numbers, okay. Any questions? So the little o, see, okay, first of all, little, if I say that some function is little o h, right, this little o h means that if you take little o h by h, this goes to 0 as, in this case, h goes to 0, that is what little o means. So, little o t to the k means that as t goes to 0, this term goes to 0 faster than t to the k, fine. So, if you are, essentially it gives you an expansion of Cx of t up to the t to the kth term, okay, plus there may be a little bit of a correction which goes to 0 faster than t to the k.
That is not a fixed thing, right? That can be
anything. That may not, see, that depends on the characteristic function. Right. So, we are saying that as long as the kth moment exists, in this sense, as long as the kth moment exists, the structure of the characteristic function up to the kth term is very well determined by this, by the moment. Beyond that, there is a little bit of a correction term, okay. Sorry. Yes, this is used a lot in, see, I mean, the computer scientists use this O notation a lot, right. Computer scientists use big O for big O and small o, right. Big O is used for upper bound. So, when you say that some algorithm is like order n squared or something, the time complexity of it is at most like n squared, right. So, the time complexity divided by n squared will go to some constant, but in this case it has to go to 0, which means the little o means that it is quicker than what is inside here, it goes to 0 quicker than what is inside, okay. So, big O and small o are different, okay, and this is a small o, okay. Let me just actually say a small o, okay. Not big O, right, then that would be a very different statement, this is small O, okay. Okay. Any questions? Okay, so I will stop here.